Today is the first Sunday after the Epiphany. The Christmas decorations have all been taken down and stored away for next year. The season that begins on the day of the Epiphany is for many people a time of letting go of the stress and busyness of the holiday season that we just went through. It's a time when maybe we feel like we can breathe until the Lenten season begins on Ash Wednesday. It's part of what is called ordinary time. Those times during the church year when nothing major is going on. It's not Advent or Christmas, Lent, Easter, or Pentecost. Ordinary time is when we hear the stories of Jesus' daily life and ministry from the time of his baptism until the time of his death. During ordinary time, the drape out front is green, and I wear a green stole, the color of hope and growth. Ordinary time sounds, ordinary. Not special. Same old, same old. But this season after the Pentecost, after the Magi arrived to worship the newborn king, and after the prophets in the temple recognized the child Jesus as the Messiah, this is a time of new things. Jesus was a new thing come into the world, and his coming was heralded by a magnificent star, a new thing in the night sky. And it fulfilled the word of God, who said to the people through the prophet Isaiah, "See, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare." New things abound right now. It's the new year. At First Christian Church, we will soon have a new budget and new officers. We are making changes to the sanctuary so it's more welcoming. That's why the "please excuse our construction" signs are on the door. We're going to adopt a cop or two. We went visiting last week, and we experienced a different kind of worship than we have every Sunday here. In a few weeks, although we're not quite sure when, the Pella Lutheran folks will come and visit us here in this place. And then maybe we'll start discussions about what it might be like if we became one congregation. We'll see. It's a new idea for us. New things can be frightening because it's change. And, people really don't like change very much. It's easier just to keep on doing what we've always done at home, at work, at church. I know you got a routine at home. You do this and then this and then this and then this because it's the way you've done it. I hate it when I do something backwards. I'm like, what comes next? I don't know. We're used to doing things a certain way. The people of Israel kept doing the same things. All through the Hebrew Bible, we see the people who have just been saved from some terrible thing clean up their acts, get all passionate about their God, and do all the right things. And then the right things become routine. Worship and giving are no longer a response to God's love, but just the things that they do because the law says they should do them. They stopped caring about the welfare of the widow and the orphan and the stranger in their land, and expecting the temple to take care of them. I mean, that's what they paid their tithe for, after all. And God noticed. And God tried to get their attention. Sent prophets to shake them out of their complacency. But the leaders didn't listen, and the people suffered. And when it got bad, when the nation had drifted too far from the Lord and bad things started happening, the people cried out and said, "Save us, Lord, and we promise we will never do that again." I've heard that before. But God always forgave. Always sent somebody to save them, a general or a great leader, a warrior maybe. Until finally, because the people kept repeating the same behavior over and over, God sent a new kind of Messiah. The one whose coming was foretold by Isaiah. Not a noble or a great warrior or a judge, but an ordinary man. A teacher and a healer. who would care deeply for the injured, the bruised reed and the dimly burning wick, who would preach justice for all people to all nations, and whose voice would quietly convince those who heard it, not overwhelm them with noise, and in that way, that quiet way, change their hearts so that they stopped repeating the same behaviors over and over again, so that their souls would be healed and their passions would be engaged in the right things for the right reasons, not because the law said do that thing, but because their hearts said do that thing, because they loved each other. And they loved all the world as deeply as God loved them in response to God's gift of love. That is what Jesus does for us. Sometimes the loud voices of the world overwhelm us. They drown out that still, small voice that speaks to our hearts. We may find it easier to just keep doing what we've always done than to seek new ways to do and be. We do all the things we're supposed to do because that's what we do, but maybe not because we're still caring passionately about those things. Or maybe we stop doing those things that we used to be passionate about because nothing is changing. It doesn't matter what we do. Everything stays the same. Our efforts seem to be in vain. Maybe a new thing, a new idea, a new focus is what we need in our lives to reignite that passion. And so, there's another new thing. Clergywomen friends of mine have been posting in our groups about what their star word is for this year. Well, I had no idea what a star word was, so I looked it up, of course. I went to my friends' blogs and I went to articles that they had written and found out about star words. I have to be really careful not to say Star Wars because, you know, it's not that. Star words are words that are written on stars to remind us of the star that heralded Jesus' birth. And everybody gets one. A gift to commemorate the gifts the Magi brought. And that word, that star word, becomes our individual focus for the year. There are 150 different words and stars, so that no one will have the same word as anybody else. Because we're all different, so we'll all use our words differently. Some may not pay much attention to them at all. Some will wonder why they got the word they got. And they'll pay close attention to that word in their life. It is suggested that you hang it up someplace on a mirror or the refrigerator, or I don't know. Can't put it on your rearview mirror, that's against the law, but someplace where you can see it regularly. One woman on her blog wrote that her word last year was restraint, and she lost 90 pounds just by focusing on that word, restraining herself from taking that second helping, that bigger piece of pie, that handful of cookies. The star words are gifts. They will be distributed in offering trays. As you reach into the tray to get your star, and no looking, you have to just take whatever you get, you do not get to choose your word. Consider that in this instance, the offering tray is going to come to you and nobody's going to ask you to put anything in it. What you receive here is a gift. A gift that's a reminder of this is the way that God's world works. God gives first, and then we are invited to respond with gifts and with ourselves. So if I could get like three deacons. And just, you know, pass them along. Nobody gets to look. No, I want you to take one. Okay, there you are. I knew you were someplace.
It's okay.
Okay. Now, while they're distributing those, let us be wise. And when you get your word, contemplate it for a moment. May the word you have received bless your life. Now please stand and join me in singing This Is the Day of New Beginnings.